of this visible of the white recommendations for dialysis patients. Similarly, the KDIGO guidelines for management of blood pressure and chronic kidney disease published last year. Perhaps this may be due to absence of clear evidence for characterization and management of blood pressure on dialysis. So I'd like first to ask you, what do you think the prevalence of hypertension in dialysis is? Clear answer on the right answer. This, I think we will all agree that it is common to the extent of more than 80% of patients on dialysis in some reports. Okay, so the second question is, how can we define hypertension on dialysis? In other terms, what is the goals of your blood pressure on dialysis? Okay. 180%. Okay. Any other goal or number? Do you possibly want? Okay. Okay. 140 over 90 except diabetic patients, 130 over 80. Any other suggestion?
No.
Okay. So this is the K2K guidelines from 2005, stating that pre-dialysis blood pressure should be below 140 over 90, whilst post-dialysis blood pressure should be 130 over 80. However, this clear-cut definition of blood pressure seems not working nowadays. Here, look at this study which included about 300 dialysis patients and followed up them for more than 30 months. You can note that mortality is lowest when blood pressure comes like that, from 110 to 130. But you can also note that not only mortality increases when blood pressure comes up, but also it increases when blood pressure comes down. What's called bimodal distribution or U-shaped relation. Another study on a large number of dialysis patients confirmed that low systolic blood pressure is not good. And the KDIGO report from 2009 suggests that don't be happy when blood pressure comes normal or even a little bit low on dialysis, because this might reflect some cardiac disease. So there is a difficulty to determine the exact number or figure of blood pressure on dialysis. So that this clear, humble definition seems not working. So that the next updates of K2K, where to divide of numbers, just advise us to render our patients hemolytic and normal tense. And the European guidelines for management of hypertension published this year find it difficult to determine any precise blood pressure targets on dialysis. Also, the same difficulty confronted with the UK Renal Association and their guidelines, but they suggest that intradiabetic systolic blood pressure shouldn't exceed 160 and don't treat if pre-dialysis systolic blood pressure is below 120. So 120 to 160, a big range. So, seems this naive advice from Mizo and Henry about 15 years ago that we have to individualize the patients. issue, which is more important, systolic, diastolic, or mean blood pressure? So I think systolic blood pressure will be more informative and lead to mortality of dialysis shown by this study. And another question about measurement of blood pressure on dialysis. We have routine pre and post dialysis blood pressure measurement, which we all perform for our patients, and we have some inter dialysis blood pressure measurement, ambulatory and self-assessed blood pressure. What do you think about them? What do you think about this measurement? Is it valid to measure blood pressure before dialysis and after dialysis? And if valid, if it is completely valid and you don't need anything else?
هو بتبقى طبعا بتفرق معايا البري عن البوست عشان اقدر احدد البيشنت لو عدلت على دراي ويت وبين الجلسات وبعضها عشان لو في اللي هو لاكتينوم ممكن تبقى في يوم.
So I think perfect answer. There is a trend in general population and also in dialysis patients that home monitor and measure the blood pressure may be feasible. And link it more to mortality. Why blood pressure measured in dialysis unit had no prognostic value? Pre-dialysis blood pressure overestimates ambulatory end-dialysis blood pressure, while post-dialysis blood pressure underestimates it. Self-assessed blood pressure by the patients at home is much more linked to ambulatory blood pressure. Ambulatory blood pressure means that the patient will wear a special machine to measure blood pressure every about 30 minutes in between dialysis sessions. While self-assessed home blood pressure measurements means that the patient will measure blood pressure to himself by an easy used machine, calibrated the machine 3 times per day, and then the average of the whole day will be calculated. So, self-measured and ambulatory blood pressure in the range of 110 to 130 of systolic seems associated with the best prognosis. Another point which makes just mere blood pressure measurements during the dialysis not that very feasible, what's called the urinary variation or dip phenomenon. Normally, we have, all of us have blood pressure to go down during night, and this will relax cardiovascular system. Unfortunately, hemodialysis patients have a problem with this diurnal variation, so this nocturnal dip is absent. So he might be still hypertensive even at night. That's why you have to monitor blood pressure at home to discover this problem. So this is a recommendation that during the dialysis blood pressure measurement was not omitted. You have to do it, and you have also to monitor blood pressure during the dialysis as we all do, but at the same time you might need ambulatory or home blood pressure monitoring in some patients. For example, those patients who complain of hypotensive symptoms at home and you can't find any hypotension in dialysis, or those patients who have a very big difference between pre and post dialysis blood pressure due to very huge amount of fluid removal, so that before dialysis he is hypertensive and after dialysis he is hypotensive. So you have to accurately measure through home measurements. Another question, I mean, sometimes we are confronted with patients who performed multiple early fistulae and his hands are not suitable to measure blood pressure. What do you usually do? So, yes, use your limbs, but remember to choose the appropriate cup size and to measure it only in supine position. Okay, what are the causes of hypertension in dialysis? What do you think is the most common cause? Dry weight. So clearly we will all agree that overload is the most important cause of hypertension in dialysis. However, this is a study entailed about 500 patients and trying to characterize dry weight not only on trial and error basis, but also on some objective rule, which here it is. Five endless machine. I think this talk is not in this study. This lecture is out of this detailed description, but this is a machine which tries to characterize dry weight through electric current passage through the body. And interestingly, they found that 15% of our patients are hypertensive and hypokalemic, which is usual for all of us. However, there were 13% hypertensive patients who are non or hypovolemic. On the other hand, there were about 10% of hypervolemic patients who were hypotensive. So, volume might not be the only cause of hypertension on dialysis. What are other causes you think might be?
Erythropoietin,
yes. Endothelial. Yes. So, stiffness human. Yes. Okay. So, all of them are right. Or overactivity of renin angiotensin system. Arterial stiffness. Glycation in the rodents. And what's called lag phenomenon. When you are confronted with a patient with hypertension and overload and you are removing fluid on dialysis and the blood pressure is not coming down, wait for a while, because sometimes there is a lag up to several months between normalization of dry weight and the drop of blood pressure due to some mechanisms in very sodium reflux. So, and also hyperglycemia might be a cause of hypertension in dialysis. Others like erythropoietic stimulating agents, original kidney disease, sympathetic overactivity, endothelin, all these might be causes of hypertension without overload. So, clearly, we will treat our patients with removal of excess fluid and the control of sodium, right? And here is the recommendation that you restrict sodium and decrease dry weight is the first line of management for your hypertensive patients. But we have a problem with dry weight characterization and determination. It depends on trial and error, and even trials to use five endpoints I have just mentioned, and blood volume monitoring, which puts small machine on the extra circuit line to determine whether there is dehydration or overhydration. All these things till now are practical, and we are still depending on clinical judgment. But please remember that you have to do it smoothly. Remember that overshooting dry weight might endanger the patient, the heart, the brain, the gut. And remember, the lag phenomenon. You might go to dry weight and still blood pressure is high. Wait for a while, blood pressure might come down. What about drugs? This is sodium restriction. And in hypertensive patients, try to avoid IV sodium levels. Even if the patient had hypotensive episodes, you might use hypertonic glucose. And there are some studies about decreasing sodium dialysate to be approximate to the patient to avoid sodium load. Avoid giving the patient IV saline during start or finish of dialysis. Okay, so regarding antihypertensive drugs, unfortunately, there are some speculations, assumptions that some type antihypertensive drugs might be better than others, but the matter of fact is, till now, the type antihypertensive is not that important. It is limited by the general condition of the patient like any other patient. There is attraction for ACE inhibitor or ARBs because of renin-angiotensin system, but till now this hasn't been proven, and remember that they might have some side effects like resistance to EPO, hyperkalemia, and some inflammatory reaction. In patients with residual kidney function, ACE, ARBs might be useful to preserve kidney function, but remember that the recent guidelines do not recommend the combined use of both of them. You have to use either of them. Diuretics has no big role in our hemodialysis patients, might have role in more in peritoneal dialysis patients. So these are the drugs, and remember that some drugs need modification and or supplementation of dialysis. And fortunately, almost all ARBs, calcium channel blockers, and alpha blockers do not need any modification or post-dialysis supplementation. This will make their use easier. Another point to control blood pressure is frequent dialysis. You know, three times dialysis will make the patient going like U-shape, up and down, but there are some studies on frequent dialysis, daily dialysis, nocturnal dialysis, which makes blood pressure much more controlled. What about resistant cases? I think we are all confronted with patients with very resistant hypertension, not responding to anything. So, our policy here in the center to use minoxidil only if we have four maximum drugs. We shift to minoxidil if blood pressure is still uncontrolled. This is not an absolute rule, but I'm just telling you about our usual practice to shift to minoxidil if the blood pressure is not controlled on four, and we all know that minoxidil has many side effects.
Not available.
Transdermal clonidine is not also available in Egypt. It is available in Europe, and it is performed by the same company which releases Catalpress. Shift to peritoneal dialysis will not be practical, especially in Egypt. So what about bilateral nephrectomy? Early studies proved some benefit for bilateral nephrectomy for resistant patients with high blood pressure on dialysis. However, subsequent studies didn't prove that effect. And still in Mansoura here, we perform bilateral nephrectomy, especially for patients on dialysis with uncontrolled blood pressure and who will not go for, who will go for transplantation because we will use other medicines which will increase blood pressure, like steroids, like calcineurin inhibitors. But unfortunately, our series hasn't been published yet. We were confronted with highly resistant patients, and this made us to try to find any unconventional way to treat hair on dialysis. And this was renal sympathetic denervation, which means interventional catheter to go to the renal artery and to denervate it. And there are some trials proving efficacy to improve blood pressure, and it is not good for it's costly to get them, like the catheter, single use, مش عارف ليه single use, بتاخد حوالي 50 60,000, في المنظر بتاخد حوالي 50-60,000. Also, baroreceptor stimulation is another attractive treatment which entails placement of permanent electrodes near the baroreceptors to stimulate them. This might decrease blood pressure also. Just two words about what's called intradialytic hypertension. Have you been confronted with patients with normal blood pressure before dialysis and then blood pressure comes up during or after dialysis? And what do you think the cause of this rise in blood pressure? Okay. So these are the proposed mechanisms you have already mentioned, but surprisingly, there is, an interest about overload. So there is now, trend to consider the patient overloaded until proved otherwise, and try to rob his dry weight again. So I know this is not accepted, but this is what evidence-based say, because for the reliability of drugs, they used non-dialyzable drugs. For EPO, for example, they stopped using EPO. And there are some evidence that overload might be also the cause. And for that guy, after his strongest study in this field, he suggested to grow dry weight again and use calcium channel blocker if blood pressure is not going down, to the extent that he suggested to extend dialysis after 4 hours if blood pressure comes up, which is unpractical. Another drugs which might be attractive as carfentanil also might be useful, so calcium channel blockers and carfentanil might be specifically useful here, and try to find out any cause. But although RAS activation was not proven in this study, still it is, logically accepted. And for excessive alpha secretion, isotonic saline might be used to to correct this problem, but the most, the strongest evidence base is overload. So these are my just take home messages. Not different targets for blood pressure on dialysis. Avoid very high and very low blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure is more convenient. Think of ambulatory and self-assist blood pressure in some patients, and no special drug. Thank you.
Really, it's very interesting, and give us a very good review about everything.